thank you all so much for being here. It's so wonderful to see lots of familiar faces and lots of new faces as well. To kick off, this is the first of this semester's COBE Connect Lunch. And the idea of this lunch series is that we provide free lunch and host a series of different topics related to behavioral and emotional health. So sometimes it's researchers presenting on their data, sometimes it's other folks from the university presenting about innovative programs that they're doing related to behavioral health and wellness. And this is really, the idea is to have a forum for lots of us who are in different silos around the university, from students to Division of Student Affairs to different academic divisions, for us to all be able to come together and talk about some of these things. So I'm Danielle Dick. I am the director of COBE, the College Behavioral and Emotional Health Institute, which grew out of the Spit for Science project, which I co-founded with my colleague Ken Kendler, who's at the Virginia Institute for Psychiatric and Behavioral Genetics. And so what we thought we would do to kick off this semester is some of us were chatting and we realized it has been 7 years since we started the serious work of launching the Spit for Science project, which has ultimately grown into COBE and all of these other things. And so we thought that it would be fun to kick off the semester with an overview of the history of the project for those of you who weren't here when it launched and don't know it as intimately as some of us who've handed out tens of thousands of t-shirts over the last several years. And what I'm gonna do today is not provide so much details about any given research project, but really provide a general overview of where we started and where we have come to, and also hopefully have a dialogue about things that we can do next as well. So I want this to be informal. Feel free to stop me, ask questions, throw out ideas if they occur along the way. Otherwise, hopefully we'll have some time at the end as well to talk about things. So I'm Danielle Dick. I'm a faculty member. I'm currently in the Department of Psychology with an affiliate appointment over in Human and Molecular Genetics. I was previously in the School of Medicine in the Department of Psychiatry at the Virginia Institute for Psychiatric and Behavioral Genetics when we launched Spit for Science. And I was moved over to this campus a couple years ago to launch COBE and all of the initiatives related to undergrads that have grown out of Spit for Science. So to start from the very beginning, what Spit for Science is, for anyone out there who isn't as familiar with the project, is that the idea was to create a university-wide research opportunity for all incoming VCU students who are 18 or older. And we launched it in fall of 2011. And that was after about a year of really intense planning to get something of this magnitude off the ground. And the scientific goal was similar to the goals of many other projects that I have and that others had, which was to understand how genetic and environmental influences come together to impact substance use and other emotional health outcomes in college students. So this happens to be my particular area of research, as it was Ken Kendler's. And so the idea was really to bring this area where we have a preeminence of researchers who work in this space, to bring this home to VCU. We know that 1 in 4 individuals over the age of 18 is affected with a psychiatric or a substance use disorder, and that college age populations are really entering a high risk period for the onset of many of these challenges. In particular, we know that substance use is a big issue on college campuses. So rates of substance use double as adolescents move from adolescence into young adulthood. 40% of students report being binge drinkers, so heavy episodic drinkers. 36% report illicit drug use. The illicit drug use on college campuses, in particular marijuana, has grown considerably in recent years. And one study that was done on a cohort of students found that almost half of students at some point technically meet criteria for an alcohol or a marijuana use disorder. Now, many of them mature out of that, but the engaging in these really risky patterns of substance use can contribute to a series of other challenges while they're on campus that have the potential to really affect and sometimes derail the course of their lives. So we know it can be associated with legal consequences, with assaults, injuries, unwanted sexual encounters, and even suicide and death. And it also has a negative impact on academic performance, retention, graduation rates, other things universities care a lot about. And I'm going to actually present a little bit of new data that we have looking at that today. In addition, even for those students who are not engaging in risky substance use or practices, they're affected too. The entire university becomes affected, and the surrounding neighborhoods, and as someone who lives in the fan right next to the university, I can attest to this, because what happens is these other students get exposed to sleep and study disruptions, property damage, more physical and sexual violence, et cetera. And of course, we know that it's not just substance use, that there have been really growing rates of other kinds of mental health concerns on college campuses. 1 in 3 students report feeling so depressed it was difficult to function. 1 in 10 students report seriously considering suicide. And now over 90% of college counseling centers report an increase in both the number and severity of students who are showing up with substance use and mental health challenges. That said, colleges represent an amazing opportunity to do something about this. So there is almost no other time in an individual's life where all of their primary activities, from their social activities, their career-related activities, health, safety, well-being, it is all housed here in one place. We know they're at a really important transitional phase for establishing life practices. And while many college students will say, well, this is just college, you know, I'm just gonna buckle down for these 4 years, or I'm gonna be crazy for these 4 years, or whatever it is, and then I will go on with the rest of my life. Then I will start real life. We know that the research shows that, in fact, the practices related to health and wellness that they establish now do persist beyond college. In addition, by nature of their teaching and research missions, universities should be extremely well equipped to be the places to do something about this, to develop best practices for how to promote health and well-being. Unfortunately, when you look at the numbers nationally, we're really not. So this happens to be data on substance use, which is my area. NIAAA, the National Institute of Alcohol Abuse and Alcoholism, came out, they put together a panel of researchers, and they came out with recommendations for what is known about effective ways to address substance use in young people. Then they went back 6 years later and did a survey of hundreds of these four-year colleges across the United States. Turns out almost a quarter of them were completely unaware that the National Institutes of Health had any kind of recommendations out. Only half of them were offering anything that had any kind of documented efficacy. Almost all of them say they're doing something. Everybody knows you have to say something to check that box. But the primary approach that universities were using was education alone, which has been shown to be completely ineffective. We are in a tremendous position here at VCU, though, because we have research excellence in substance use and mental health outcomes. So when you hear Frank Macrina present the numbers, if you combine the National Institutes of Health that focus on substance use and mental health, so NIAAA, Alcohol Abuse and Alcoholism, NIDA, National Institute of Drug Abuse, and NIMH, National Institute of Mental Health, more money comes into VCU from those institutes than in any other area, including cancer. So we have tremendous research expertise here. In addition, we have amazing partners at our Wellness Center who in prevention and intervention, and more broadly in the Division of Student Affairs. And we have a university that is focused on cross-campus collaborations and promotion of student success in innovative ways. So that was really the background for launching the Spit for Science project. The idea was to bring a preeminent area of research home to our university. Because though I and others had millions of dollars in grant funding focused on substance use and mental health outcomes, most of these projects were going on at other places all around the world, not here at our university, despite the fact that these are clearly big issues on college campuses. So one of the very early questions from Bev Warren, who was then the interim provost and went on to become the provost and then, of course, now is the president of Kent State, was, what's in it for the students? The idea was that we could use this project by creating a university-wide research opportunity. We could use this project to introduce students to the importance of research at universities, that they are not just showing up to take classes and to graduate, that a big part of universities is the generation of knowledge as well, to start a dialogue about behavioral and mental health issues on college campuses, and to start a conversation about all health is a product of our predispositions and our environments and how these things come together. And the idea was that we could use our findings to feed them back to the students in ways that could benefit them. So what the project actually involves is an online 15 to 30 minute survey where students fill out a whole series of questions about their personality, their behavior, their family, friends, experiences, growing up. There's also a DNA component, so if they complete the surveys, then they can do the DNA part, which involves spitting into a test tube, hence the spit in Spit for Science, a saliva collection. And then we do longitudinal follow-up across the college years and beyond. And so the first survey invitation goes out a couple weeks before they arrive on campus. So tell us about who you are and what you're like when you show up here. The follow-up surveys are then in the spring. So how are you doing after having your first year here at VCU, and then every subsequent year thereafter? And then we've most recently launched a Beyond VCU component where we've followed up with students who have left from the university. And we did a lot of outreach about why there was a DNA component as well, because we know that environments are not the full story when it comes to substance use and mental health outcomes. In fact, when it comes to most health-related outcomes. Life is not fair. We are not all equally at risk. We're all at risk for something, but we're at risk for different things. We know that individual predispositions also play a role in who develops challenges. So the project has gone really well. We enrolled four cohorts from 2011 to 2014. About 70% of eligible freshmen completed the surveys, and it was optional as to whether they wanted to do the DNA component after they completed the survey. Almost all students, 97%, also chose to participate in the DNA portion. And I would like to think that is at least in part due to all the outreach that we did around that piece as well. And this response rate of about 70%, just to give you a reference, in other surveys that are done of college students, typical response rates are somewhere around 35%. So our students really came out and made this project a massive success. So we enrolled almost 10,000 students over those 4 years, and we're following them longitudinally. We have not enrolled students for the last couple incoming freshman cohorts, in part because that was when I was moving over to the undergraduate campus and we were focused on launching COBE, and many of these initiatives surrounded how can we actually use the research to benefit our university. But we are hoping to launch a new cohort again this fall and to find funding to do that as well. Those 10,000 students, I should mention, look tremendously representative of the university. So they map on almost exactly to overall VCU demographics in terms of the gender breakdown and the self-reported racial ethnic breakdown. So that's one of the things that we put a lot of emphasis into making sure that this was a project that everyone felt comfortable participating in. I was partnered with the then chair of African American Studies, Ashir Nassim, who of course now runs the iCubed initiative, about how can we make sure to reach out in particular to our minority students, acknowledging the history of abuses that have happened with biomedical research in those populations. So we were incredibly excited that our population of participants looks very representative of the university. In addition, what we have really done is to try and build a collaborative community of researchers. So as of a week or so ago, when we were pulling the most recent reports, there are now 62 faculty, more than 30 pre- and postdoctoral fellows from 18 different departments across both campuses who are working with the data. More than 30 faculty and students have contributed item content. So when we develop the surveys each semester, we send out a call for item content. And the idea is that that way we can put in content that's related to specific faculty or students' interests, and so that we can be generating a resource that will be beneficial for faculty development as well. And the 30 plus faculty that have contributed item content, you can see there's a whole variety of different areas, which I put up here to give you a sense of the scope and the kind of areas that are being studied in the project. So everything from pet ownership and its effects on mental health, e-cigarettes, obviously I see many of you who have contributed these items who are here in this room, physical health, parent-offspring communication, items on smoking, sleep, sound tolerance, perfectionism. You can see that we are covering a broad base of areas related to substance use and mental health outcomes. And I'm exceedingly grateful to all of you who have contributed item content to really help advance research in our students in these areas. In addition, all of the data becomes part of a registry. So any faculty member or student can apply to work with the data. And the idea is that you can both work with the existing data that we collect, but the students, when they consent to be a part of the project, are consenting to be recontacted for other potential projects. And so you can select subsets of students, either based on certain behavioral characteristics or potentially based on genotypes, for those of us that are interested in some high-risk genotypes, to do more intensive study. So to give you a flavor for some of the things that are currently going on, there's a study being led by Megan Cook for her dissertation, in which she's bringing in binge drinking, heavy drinking students and doing brain imaging on them to look at different pathways of risk. There's been a study that was looking, that brought in smokers and did ecological momentary assessments. So throughout the day, looking at associations between mood and smoking. Ananda Amstatter and several other members of her group have done more in-depth assessments of trauma and assaults in the sample. In addition, Hermeen Maz and one of her students are looking at developing personalized smoking interventions. So does incorporating information about your genetic risk, how at risk you are to develop lung cancers and otherwise, how does that inform students smoking, the efficacy of these smoking interventions? We've worked on some personalized alcohol interventions. This is work with Zoe Neal and Jeannie Savage and Kristen Donovan and others, where we're looking at, does giving feedback about one's risk profile help improve the effects of alcohol intervention? In addition, Jenny Sue, one of my postdocs, got a postdoctoral grant to do follow-up with our African-American participants to look at experiences of discrimination as well as racial ethnic identity here. So that'll be launching this spring. And one of the junior faculty in the class, in the team, also launched a study of couples looking at romantic relationships. It turns out it was exceedingly hard to get both members of a couple because we were trying to find people who weren't couples when they got here and became couples by the spring and get them both in the laboratory. And so it was a running joke among our group for a while because she would be like, anytime I'm on the campus connector and I see someone holding hands, I just want to ask them if they're in spit for science and they'll come in and do our study. So we've done a whole variety of different, I think, really interesting spin-off projects. As you can see, I think the project is really just on a sharp positive trajectory. These are publications that have come out of the project, and it obviously takes a while to get some Herculean effort like this off the ground and the database cleaned and all entered, but now we have lots of longitudinal data that's available so folks can really answer a whole variety of questions. And so we're seeing a number of publications really just coming out and growing. To give you a sampler of some of the things that are being studied in the project, we have some papers looking at substance use and what that looks like and how it changes across the first year of college. We've looked at family history of substance use and mental health problems and how that affects students and how well they do on campus. We've done some work. This was led by an undergraduate who's part of our research team looking at parenting styles and how that then affects students' alcohol use when they transition to college. We're doing some genetic work. So the genotyping has been completed on the first three cohorts now. And so some of the work being led in that area is trying to find the genes involved in why some people are more at risk than others. And so we have some of the first papers coming out in those areas as well. There's been a series of papers looking at prevalence and predictors of sexual assaults and how the experience of various types of trauma affects our students. In addition, there's been work looking at substance use and employment, at tobacco and e-cigarette use, romantic relationships in young people and how that affects their substance use. Linda and some others have looked at how effective is some of the programming, like the social norms campaign, the stall seat journals and whatnot on campus? It's effective, that's the good news. In addition, we've done some work looking at these targeted alcohol prevention programs, as well as looking at some items related to who's using the services here on campus, the mental health services. So these are some of the types of areas where we have papers already coming out. And one of the things that we're trying to be much more intentional about now that we have our feet on the ground, I think, is that Craig Zirpolo, who some of you all will know, who's in the back there behind the camera, was an undergraduate here when Spit for Science first launched over in the Robertson School of Media and Culture, and is now on our team full-time as the digital media specialist. And so if you go to the COBE website, and if you are not on our listserv, please go to the website and sign up, and then we produce weekly blogs, podcasts, other things I'll talk a bit more about. But what we're gonna do moving forward is be much more intentional about anytime a paper is coming out with data on the project, releasing a user-friendly, i.e. not just the scientific report written for other scientists, blog about what kind of things we're finding so that we can push that science back out. So there have been 19 grants awarded using the Spit for Science data now. That includes NIH grants, internal grants, and foundation grants. Six of those have been career development awards, so we're really working on using this resource to build the number of scientists who are working in this area, ranging from the pre-doc level to junior faculty. And we have a number of other grants on under review. And I just want to put out a plug that I am always happy to work with or to have, if you're a faculty member, your students work with, and I can help co-sponsor, and we can help fill in sections about Spit for Science. But we're always happy to help support any grants that want to be developed with the Spit for Science data set. And in these really competitive and tight grant times, it's good to have something that sets you apart. And so having this amazing resource as something that you can work with is, I think, something that's been very helpful in terms of getting some of these grants. So all of this was really the background behind launching COBE. So as Spit for Science started as this research idea from some conversations that Ken Kendler and I had, and has grown into this monstrous registry and project, really what became apparent is that we needed to have a mechanism to formalize this and to formalize all of the initiatives that were growing out of the science. And that was the background behind launching COBE, the College Behavioral and Emotional Health Institute, for which we just formally received university designation a little over a year ago, so November of 2015. And I think that considering we've only existed for a little over a year, we can be proud of a lot of the things that we have accomplished. And by we, I really do mean it's clearly happening with everyone in this room. It's certainly not me doing all of these things. So the idea behind COBE was really that we could promote behavioral and emotional health in college communities by integrating the research with the coursework, programming, policy, all related to behavioral and emotional health. In other words, the idea was to create an umbrella that brings together all the researchers who work in this space, who are spread all around the campus, and to connect the researchers with all the folks who are involved in working with our students who are having challenges. So the folks in Division of Student Affairs, to create innovative opportunities to bring this information to our students and to support our students and our broader community. So really what I'm going to talk a little bit about today is some of the primary areas where we focused. I've started off talking about the research that we're doing, and I'm going to talk a little bit about how we've used that research then to inform new teaching and other translational opportunities here at the university. So the first foray into undergraduate teaching was that from the very beginning, the idea was if we're going to create a big project with the students, Spit for Science, that they should have opportunity to be engaged in that research project. And so we launched the Spit for Science research course, which was really tremendous work from several of my postdocs across the years went into that, from Alexis Edwards to Jessica Salvatore, and now it's really Amy Adkins who has assumed responsibility and just grown this program, and it's taken off. So we've worked with more than 160 undergraduates from 16 different departments and programs. So it is intentionally interdisciplinary. It's listed through multiple departments, and the idea is to provide a research-intensive course for our students. So graduate students and postdocs mentor different groups of undergraduates, and they learn how to conduct research. They come up with research questions. They're involved in analyzing the data and then presenting the results. And Amy pulled together what I thought was this neat map where it's showing that the projects, the product that the students produce at the end of the course, then all get uploaded at the library into their scholarship reports there, and they've been downloaded more than 1,000 times. So our undergrads research is actually getting out there as well. So you can see down here more than 1,000 downloads in the last year from really all around the world. The other piece that's been very gratifying is that the students love it. And so we create an alumni group of the students who have been through the Spit for Science research course. Their evaluations are overwhelmingly positive, and they talk about this being a really profound experience, which we know maps onto the literature about engaged experiential learning and the opportunity to be involved in research. So just to give you an idea of where this has taken off, we can only take a small number of students since it's a very research intensive class. We had 117 students apply, not even just try and sign up. They actually had to fill out an application for 15 slots for this spring. In addition, we offer more intensive research experiences. So we've had 17 students come through and do research internships, so one-on-one research projects. And you can see that there's a whole variety of different majors that are represented here and different faculty that we have partnered with on this. A new thing that Amy has launched just last summer was the research boot camp, which was in response to the fact that there was so much interest in the Spit for Science research course. So this is a week-long intensive experience, which was really, again, driven by Amy and several other postdocs and students in who work with me. And the students learn basic statistics. They learn how to work with the Spit for Science database. We had 19, we really just kind of quietly launched it as a pilot, and we had 19 students who signed up and did it, several of whom went on to do independent studies. And what we really want to do for this upcoming year is be much more intentional, because the idea is to make them useful. And by that, I mean, all of us who have worked with undergraduates know that it can sometimes be challenging to bring them up to speed. So you are doing a lot more of training of them than they are actually useful to you in terms of generating research product. And so what we want to do is help reduce that bar to get students into faculty members' labs. And so by teaching them about basic statistics and by training them up on the Spit for Science database, which for those of you that have worked with, you can imagine 10,000 students, all these longitudinal assessments, lots of different survey content from one to the next. It is a huge code book. We've tried to be very organized about it, but it can be overwhelming to get into. So we're training the students on how to work with it. So the idea is that then we can pair them up with the faculty who've contributed item content so that they can be helping those faculty to actually get into the database and work with their data. So it will be mutually beneficial. So that's where we're really hoping to go with this. Another course that we have launched is the Science of Happiness. And this is a team-taught interdisciplinary course. I see several folks who contribute to it, and, including Ev, sitting out there. And the idea was, how can we take all this faculty expertise and bring it to the students? So one of the challenges in higher education, as many of us know, is that those of us who are deeply engaged in research are often not doing undergraduate teaching. We are buying out of our teaching and we are in our laboratories. And so the thought was, we have all this tremendous faculty expertise. So we really came together, a group of us who work on everything from the causes of mental health challenges to the promotion of well-being, to put together an experience that would be low burden for the faculty involved. So each of the faculty just rotate in and do one or two classes on the areas in which they have deep expertise. And we have a TA who contributes to the consistency of the experience across the course. And the idea is to introduce students to the science behind it, but also have them engage in evidence-based activities that are known to promote health and well-being and to reflect on their own personal characteristics and risk so that they can hopefully make more effective choices for their own life. And so it's a very, involves a lot of group discussions and reflective activities as well. And we launched this, again, as a pilot in the spring of 2016. We had 27 students. This course is offered through the University College, and it found a home there because the idea is that if you look at the faculty who contribute to it, we come from every school at the university. Across both campuses, all schools are represented. And so it really doesn't belong to any one department or area. And so the University College gave us a home with the idea of, well, this can be a place where all students from whatever background can apply and be a part. And the students have really enjoyed it. So I put up a couple quotes here from our pilot class. And then in the fall, we built it to 54 students. And you can see the majority of them say that they have already recommended it or are going to recommend it to other friends. An offshoot of this is that the Honors College dean got wind of this and said, this sounds really great, and I think that all of our students should have to take it. So Science of Happiness is obviously an elective course. I should mention, it currently does not count toward anything. So the students are taking it just because they want to take it, and it counts, of course, as credits, but not toward gen ed or toward a major. So we created an offshoot, which was a one-credit course, which essentially condenses and gives them a little bit of the scientific content, but a lot of the discussion interaction. And it's led by different TAs. And again, the students really enjoyed it. And I think the piece that they reflected back that they enjoyed was that it didn't feel to them just like, oh, you know, we get all these health and wellness study things. Like, yes, we should do yoga, and yes, we should do coloring, and yes, we should. But they're like, we get the science behind it now. And they really appreciated that. So as a researcher, and since that's where these courses originated, I think that having that connection between the research and the practice has been really important in students' uptake of it. So I call it chocolate-covered broccoli, in the sense that students have to take courses while they are here. That's what they think of when they're at university. So the idea that we can both be giving them academic knowledge, they get access to all these faculty who are deep experts in these areas, but we're also giving them life skills that will hopefully promote their own health and well-being at the same time. We're hoping that that will really be a win-win. In addition, we've partnered with lots of other schools to create other experiential learning opportunities for students. And so these include things like Jay Adams and the Robertson School. We're a service learning partner for his media class, and so they have done creative marketing campaigns and whatnot for COBE, for launching Thrive, which I'll talk about in a moment, and some of the other kinds of things. So it's, we're using our students who are developing expertise in media to think about how can we use that to promote health and well-being. Our students over in Communication Arts and in the School of the Arts have designed our COBE and our Spit for Science t-shirts, so we're bringing in the art students as well. And Lisa Freeman and I have had conversations about collaborative things that we could do when the ICA launches as well. And we've created other sorts of opportunities where in different content areas that are associated with different disciplines, we can connect up with health and well-being. So I throw this out there because if there are areas that you can think of where there are connections between health, well-being, the research, anything that you want to integrate into your courses, then we would love to partner with you. In addition, what we're trying to do is take all this research and to translate it into the prevention and intervention and other ways that students are experiencing the university. And so I'm going to touch on just a few of these here. So the Well, Linda Hancock, Kristen, Tricia, and others here, they have been absolutely tremendous partners from the very beginning. And so we partner with Linda. She has kindly allotted us a little bit of time in Spit for Science for us to first launch, or in her Love and Liquor, to first launch Spit for Science and to introduce that to all the students, and now to introduce COBE to the students. In addition, in the Stall Seat Journals, we spotlight some of the research findings, and we were just talking about having that kind of be a regular feature where we'll take research that comes out of Spit for Science and have a little corner, you know, research focus in some creative way to keep reemphasizing the connections between research and the practices of students here. In addition, we're working right now with a private company, Seven Cups of Tea. Some of you all might have been here when Glenn Moriarty came and talked about his company. It is an online platform to promote peer-to-peer support. And one of the things in that are growth pathways. And so we are working with him, and Kristen Donovan has been a huge person in leading this, to develop interactive personalized growth pathways related to substance use. So how can we take what we know from research about who's most at risk and what we know from what are the effective pieces of the current prevention and intervention programming and potentially create more personalized interventions for students and then do the research to see if it makes a difference. So those are some of the things we have underway. In addition, we received a Quest Innovation Award, and Amy Atkins led this, in which we have merged the Spit for Science data with all these other university data sets. which was a Herculean effort. And if Nate Thomas is here somewhere, he is the research assistant in our group who did all of the hard work of taking all of these data sets. We're in a whole series of different formats, as you might imagine, and putting them all together. And what this really will allow us to do is to take all this behavioral health information that we have collected on students and to map it onto the information that we have about their engagement in university activities, their GPA, their whether or not they stay here at the university. And this is really an incredibly unique opportunity because, to our knowledge, no one else has a data set of this sort. When many universities are, of course, thinking about how do you improve retention, but most universities only have data to have access to the academic data, to what courses they're in, how well they do in their courses. And so they can work on things like the course sequencing and support systems academically. But we know that it's not just how well students do in Psych 101 that contributes to whether or not they stay at the university and how well they're doing here. Clearly, what's going on in the rest of their lives makes a big impact. So this will really enable us to better study those pathways. So just to give you a quick look at this is our, some of the hot off the press things. What this shows here is, in Spit for Science, the number of substances that students are endorsing using. So alcohol, cigarettes, tobacco, other illicit drugs. As they endorse more substances, this is the likelihood that they're going to drop out of the university. And this is combining, you can see multiple waves, and so it's really consistent. So as they're using more drugs, likelihood of dropout clearly escalates. This is looking at not just substance use, but also other kinds of getting in trouble. So a questionnaire that looks at smoking cigarettes, getting drunk, having problems with alcohol, getting in trouble with the law, et cetera. Similar pattern here. The more challenges that they report, their chance of dropout significantly increases here at the university. And one more positive piece of things, if you kind of ignore all the variation here and you just sort of look at these lines, the trends, then what this is showing is the average weekly visits to rec sports. So this could be across, they're engaged in teams, they're logging in to work out at the gym, any of those kind of things. And this is across each of the 4 years. So this is in the first year, second year, third year, fourth year. And what you can see is that the more engaged they are, the more they're involved in healthy activities, their chance of dropping out significantly goes down. So we're able, these are just little snippets of some of the information that we have, but everything that we have in all the data we have in Spit for Science and the university data sets that we are able to merge in, we can now look at to have a better picture of how to support our students. Another thing we've launched this year is the Thrive Living Learning Residence Hall. This was a partnership with Residence Life. And you can sort of think of these, Aspire would be the big version of there's a learning component and a living component. We launched on just a pilot on a couple of residence halls. And so we are a baby program in residence. And all the students are enrolled in the Science of Happiness course. And then the idea is to coordinate with other divisions like Rec Sports, the Wellness Center, and the faculty who are engaged in Science of Happiness to create living experiences that further support and promote well-being. So they'll have both the academic content and then have that connected to their lived experiences at the university. In addition, we are hosting our second annual town hall. This is really an idea that was the brainchild of Tom Bannard, who's the administrative director of COBE and also who leads RAMS and Recovery. And the idea was that we can highlight both VCU speakers as well as bring in outside speakers. So we bring together a diversity of audiences to focus on issues related to substance use and mental health in young people. So when Tom came to me with this idea, I said, that sounds like a great idea, but I'm a researcher, so I know researchers and I know the university, but all those other worlds out there, the substance use communities and the folks who are involved in treatment or whatnot, that's not my world. So this is gonna have to be kind of your baby, and if you think you can make it work, go for it. And we had more than 300 attendees when we launched it last year for the first time. And it was so successful that he has now developed a partnership with the Virginia Department of Behavioral Health, who is co-sponsoring this year's Research to Recovery Symposium. So mark your calendars. We'd love to have you there. Finally, one of the things we really want to do with our media is to spread the science. So we've created the COBE website, which has had a lot of visits to it, which is great. In addition, we've created these social media accounts, and these are largely all led by Craig. You can follow VCU COBE on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. And in addition, what we're doing is working on putting together the content onto YouTube, and so there's a COBE YouTube channel as well, where we'll be putting things like scientific talks, etc., up there. In addition, Craig has launched a Why Science podcast, where they're about 15 minutes, and a number of you in here I can see have done some of them, and the whole idea is both talking to scientists about how they ended up in science and what their career path was, as well as what kind of things they're working on. If you would like to do one of these, we would love to spotlight you and your work. So please follow up with me. It can sometimes be a bit of a challenge to get faculty and students to want to come into the soundproof room and do this, but I promise it's easy and it's fun. In addition, we have a monthly newsletter that we put out with the blogs and the Why Science podcast, and it's a great way to keep up with everything that's going on. We have just hired a new part-time director of community engagement, and that's Patsy King, who's back there. Do you want to raise your hand, Patsy? Who we're really excited about. She is someone who moved to Richmond a couple years ago, is passionate about substance use and mental health outcomes in young people. And so we're going to be working on trying to develop strategic partnerships with groups in the community that have shared interests. And so obvious ones that we want to really work on building a tighter collaboration and communication with would be parents of our students who care quite a bit about how their students are doing and their abilities to succeed here. Daphne Rankin has put together this wonderful Beyond Orientation course for parents, and I do one of the classes as part of that, and they're always incredibly concerned about substance use and mental health outcomes on college campuses. So another place that there's obvious room for partnership is with the schools. That's a place where there is tremendous potential to impact young people. And like colleges, they are often not doing evidence-based practices. And some of the things we really hope to do is to both raise awareness about COBE and about the kind of research that we're doing, as well as think about how can we develop new initiatives that are really mutually beneficial. One of the things that Patsy has done is work with Sally Mountcastle, who leads our Eat, Sleep, Move group here, and put together a new course offered through Health and Human Performance, a yoga class called Skills for On and Off the Mat. And so that launched this semester, and our sections filled up, and it's going great. And I have this dream that we can also put together a Science of Happiness Part 2, meaning we have our Science of Happiness, our students learn all about causes of mental health challenges and the promotion of well-being. The idea that then, equipped with that knowledge, they could go into the schools and be working with younger people and have a more hands-on experiential learning opportunity where they would also be benefiting and teaching the younger folks. I think that that's something else that there's a lot of potential for us to think about developing. So to wrap up, when I was meeting with Bev Warren at some point back in 2010, and we were trying to sell the idea of launching this university-wide project, she said, "Spit for Science, if we're going to do this, and I will open the doors to help you do this, but it has to be about more than the research of two faculty members. This cannot be about Danielle Dick and Ken Kendler's research project. This really has to be about what the project can do for our students and for our university." And I think that fast forward 7 years, it's really exciting to me to see all of the things that we have built around this. And I think that we have fulfilled our promise that we would actually do that. And it's really my hope that this is just the very beginning of what we can do. And I'm excited to see where we can take this over the next 7 years. So I want to end by thanking all of you, because I intentionally did not put up an acknowledgement slide with names, because I started to and I realized I cannot begin to thank all of the folks who contribute to this project and all of these initiatives, because none of this would be possible without tremendous work from everyone in this room, from the faculty that have contributed to the coursework, who are giving their time to do these kind of things, to my students and postdocs who have been the workhorses when I come up with a crazy new idea and I'm sure did not know they were signing up to pass out tens of thousands of t-shirts to undergraduates when they came to work with me, to the faculty who have been such amazing partners in really welcoming these researchers who were late to the show of, hey, so what are we doing in prevention and intervention here at our university? And how could we all come together to build things? It has been so wonderful to have such great partners from all around the university. And so I really am exceedingly grateful to all of you, including the folks who at the very beginning were really skeptical, and I would say challenged us on whether Spit for Science was actually going to in any way benefit the university, or was it just going to be another research project that would come and go? Because I think that it was with everyone's input that all of these things happened. They pushed us to think about things that we never would have otherwise. So with that, thank you all for making this such a success. I am incredibly grateful, and I'm excited to see where we all go next. Thanks.